Honourable Subhanjiran. Honourable Subhanjiran.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As we consider the new standing orders and code of conduct for members of parliament, it seems ironic that we are discussing these two documents, which are important documents for the conduct of business in parliament, on a day when there seems to be so much uncertainty in the country with regard to Prime Minister, Cabinet, Government, etc. But for the orderly conduct of business in this House, when Honourable Dinesh Gunawardena rose on a point of order this morning, consequent to a letter given to the Honourable Speaker, the Parliament Business Committee, in a very orderly manner, took the decision to debate that issue from 4 p.m. today for 3 hours. That is a testimony to the fact that amidst even such a situation where there is so much uncertainty, the business of Parliament is being conducted in an orderly manner according to the prevailing standing orders. And so, in some sense, this is an opportune moment to debate this document that has been prepared with a lot of care, as Honourable Ajit Pereira said when he introduced the documents. The Committee on Standing Orders has done a tremendous job. As I joined this Parliament, the 7th Parliament, the previous Parliament, I was on the Standing Orders Committee even during that time. And under the chairmanship of then Speaker, Honourable Chamal Rajapaksa, we met many times to review and to redraft a new Standing Orders of Parliament. Unfortunately, that effort was not concluded during that Parliament's tenure. But I'm glad that within 2.5 years of the 8th Parliament, it has been possible to present this set of standing orders and also code of conduct for members of Parliament. It is often when there is uncertainty and weakness in government that good legislative measures are taken. As I said when I started, it's ironic that we debate this today. That is yet another irony, that it is only when the government seems weak that progressive legislative measures become possible. There are many examples in this country itself. The 17th Amendment is one example. But I think the supreme example is the 19th Amendment to the Constitution. When it was a minority government, numbers of that government, members of that government were so low, and yet it was possible to enact the 19th Amendment to the Constitution with only one member voting against it. When the government seems weak, that is when it seems that consensus is possible. So today, that is why I say maybe an opportune day to actually adopt these new standing orders that have been presented to the House on a day when the country and even this Parliament seems unsure as to what governance will look like tomorrow in this country. These standing orders have been prepared by this committee, as I said, across party divides, and has brought in a number of progressive measures. Firstly, it was necessary to have a new set of standing orders because the one that we are working with even today is so old that most of those provisions had even become obsolete and unworkable. In the parliament which functions in the British parliamentary tradition, could always rely on tradition, and we have been able to go on whenever there was a casus omnibus to rely on the practice of the British Parliament, and successive speakers have been able to give rulings that have generally been accepted by the country and elsewhere as correct rulings, and the dignity of this House had been maintained up to now. Yet it has become necessary to review and to reform and renew the standing orders by which Parliament must work. More importantly, a code of conduct for members of Parliament has also been placed. This was a promise given by the government, the National Unity Government. It was an electoral pledge by this new by the new dispensation that was brought in from January 2015 to August 2015, and it may be important today to just look back on that 2.5 or 3 year period and even pat ourselves on our backs for the number of progressive legislative measures that this parliament was able to enact. After the 19th Amendment, the Right to Information Act, which, Mr. Speaker, you were the force behind it, even when you were in the opposition, was brought into operation. That has revolutionized transparency in governance in this country. That is a fact. Today, as I speak, it may seem that what was achieved or what has been going on for the last 2.5 to 3 years may come to an end or is a failure. But the fact is that a lot of the legislative measures that were adopted have gone forward, have been very progressive. The democratic reforms must be acknowledged. And one important democratic reform is strengthening of Parliament. And it is to that end that the new sectoral oversight committees have been brought in. And I agree with the Honorable Ajit Pereira that this whole concept of a sectoral oversight committee system, which seems even today alien to us, is an important measure in strengthening Parliament, Parliament's oversight. Therefore, although many ministers and other members seem dissatisfied with the fact that the system, committee system that prevailed before this, which was consultative committees, is what they want, I would urge the House to look at this slightly differently. You can have consultative committees. There is no, I'm not opposed to that. But that is a very different issue to the setting up of sectoral oversight committee. It is through the oversight committees that Parliament actually exercises, in effect exercises, even legislative control, where it is possible for members in committees to consider legislative measures that are brought, various other matters that are referred to those committees, and unless there is a committee system through which this oversight is exercised, merely debating it in the House, in public, when members are grouped in sharply divided compartments of their respective political parties, will not bring about much good. So as we all know, it is in the committees that a lot of constructive work is done. And therefore, the introduction of oversight committees is a very, very important step, a progressive step that was taken by this Parliament, even without amending the standing orders, by resolution of this House, those were set up. And now, today, it is being brought in into the standing orders, and that is to be welcomed. I know there is an amendment that may be moved to retain the functioning of the consultative committees as well. So that can happen. That is a totally different issue altogether. But I want to impress on the members not to compare the two, even in this debate today, because we hear this all the time. Those who want the consultative committees revived keep attacking the sectoral oversight committee, particularly the ministers. Actually, sectoral oversight committees, as the name itself suggests, is an oversight function, and understandably, ministers are not in not too much in favor of that. But if we are serious about strengthening the institution of Parliament, then oversight committees are an essential feature of that. And as the Honorable Ajit Pereira also mentioned, a new committee, the Public Finance Committee, which I have the honor of chairing for the present, has been entrusted with the Parliament's special function of exercising total control over public finance. Now, that is there in the Constitution. But we saw how ineffective that was in actual practice. But here is an opportunity now, through the working of that important committee, that Parliament's important role of being the sole authority, the one who exercises the sole control over public finance, to exercise it in a meaningful way. And there are many more measures that need to be taken, particularly the Office of Parliamentary Budget Office, which is essential for the functioning of that committee, and also for various other reasons of advising members of Parliament with regard to budgetary procedures and generally with regard to public finance. Unfortunately, the legislation in that regard has also got delayed, but I hope very soon, in the next few months, we would be able to set that up as an independent office that is not attached to the Ministry of Finance, but something that comes within the control of Parliament, something that functions independently, to be able to advise this House, not the government, but this House, on very acutely technical matters with regard to finance, so that the members of this House can involve themselves in intelligent debate. I want to also refer to the other important matter that Honorable Ajit Pereira referred to, and that is the removal of judges. Now, this actually came to a head, as he said, with the removal or the purported removal of Chief Justice of that time, Dr. Shirani Bandaranaike. But it did not begin at that time. The very first impeachment of a judge, which was also a Chief Justice, Neville Samarakorn, and the Parliament did it through a committee appointed for that purpose. Then itself, this issue arose. Unfortunately, Honorable Dinesh Gunawardena is not in the House at the moment, but he gave a dissent. Honorable Anurabha Bandaranaike and Honorable Dinesh Gunawardena gave a dissent, stating that the inquiry procedure by members of Parliament, particularly over those who exercise judicial function, was not desirable. Unfortunately, that was not rectified. It had to be rectified. Even now, I wish to state that bringing the new standing order provisions in that regard are not sufficient, because the Constitution in Article 107, as interpreted by the Supreme Court as well, there are certain segments of that procedure that must be prescribed by law and not by standing orders. And standing orders recognizes that. It says that law in that regard must be enacted, and I hope that that is enacted. Again, the crucial factor to be considered in this is the independence of that inquiry panel. Much more than anything else, I would say even more than what is invariably referred to as the supremacy of Parliament, is the independence of that inquiry panel. It's a mistaken notion to say Parliament is supreme. Perhaps under the first Republican Constitution that was true, but under the present Constitution, it is the Constitution that is supreme. The Constitution says so. Parliament is supreme in the functions that have been delegated to Parliament, in the legislative functions. Of course, Article 3 of the Constitution, Article 4 of the Constitution says judicial power of the people is also exercised by Parliament through courts, except when it is in connection with the powers and privileges of Parliament or members of Parliament. Now, removal of a judge or inquiry into allegations of misconduct or incapacity of a judge, of a Superior Court judge, is not a matter that comes within the purview of powers and privileges of Parliament or its members. That is a matter that is, yes, a judicial power exercised by Parliament, but through courts. And so that is where a mechanism that is consonant with that principle, where the inquiry procedure is a fair procedure, is in accordance with laws of natural justice, laws of procedural fairness, etc., must be strictly complied with. And it is for that reason that retired judges of the Supreme Court have been suggested in the standing orders or prescribed, and that three of those persons must be appointed by the Speaker in consultation with the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition, so that there is a bipartisan view as to who constitutes that panel. But I would urge that in regard to this matter, that this House actually considers employing judges from other countries. Now, when I say this, there will automatically be reaction in the House saying we are allowing for foreign interference and so on. This seems an unnecessary fear that many members have. After all, our judges function in many foreign jurisdictions. Even while they are judges here, they have been given leave, and they function in courts elsewhere. Our Supreme Court judges have conducted inquiries into the conduct of other judges in other jurisdictions. In Malaysia, for instance, Justice Mark Fernando, Justice Parindarana Singha have, with distinction and with acceptance, played that role. We are an island, and perhaps that island mentality sometimes overcomes us. But we are a country which is a part of a community of nations, of a civilized group of countries. And if we are so paranoid all the time, to the extent that we cannot accept independent advice and assistance from others around us, then we will not make much progress. So I urge this House to keep aside the unnecessary paranoia and look to what is good, what the ideal is, what is sought to be achieved, which is independence. There is a criticism on what has been formulated here, saying even if you say retired judges, it may be judges who retired recently, so it may be judges who have actually worked with the accused judge, and there can be lack of independence, etc. But if you actually take it away from the country, you can achieve the objective of an independent inquiry. And that is the most important thing, because we are talking about judges of the superior courts, Chief Justice and other judges of the Supreme Court, President of the Court of Appeal and other judges of the Court of Appeal. The two apex courts, the Supreme Court is the apex court, the other Court of Appeal exercises superior court's functions. And if we are to strengthen the independence of the judiciary, judges of the superior court must be able to function without fear of interference into their activity, not only by the executive, but also by the legislature. Because that is the institution that is at the vanguard, that is the institution that actually protects, that is beyond the political vicissitudes. That is the one that people can repose their confidence in. So much more for persons who occupy positions in those courts, that they should know that when their matter comes up or there is an allegation against them, that the procedure that is in place to inquire into that is no second to the judicial system that we have for any other citizens. And that is where we failed with regard to the inquiry into the alleged misconduct on Dr. Shirani Bandaranaike. The hasty way in which the Committee of Parliament functioned, the manner in which 16 witnesses were examined in one night, the fact that by 8 a.m. the next morning, a report was ready and tabled in this House. Almost impossible humanly task had been performed. That mighty rush showed showed up the flaws in that procedure, and that too in respect of the Chief Justice of that of the country. So that is why this was brought into sharp focus. And at that time, I remember as a opposition member, Dr. Vijayadasa Rajapaksa introduced a bill, a private member's bill, on removal of judges. And there he proposed, where it is the Chief Justice, to invite sitting judges from other jurisdictions to constitute that panel of inquiry. So this is something that many countries, particularly in the Commonwealth, we say the Commonwealth because at least within the Commonwealth, judicial systems are comparable, and in most instances, we function with the same principles. And therefore, it becomes easier for judges from other jurisdictions to perform that function. Now, we already have this in our system. Where commercial disputes are concerned, or even other disputes are concerned, the Arbitration Act in Section 5 permits that. We participate in international arbitrations. International arbitrations take place in this country, where panels of arbitrators from other countries come and sit, and they make awards. And those have to be implemented through the court system in this country, even today. You can't set aside an arbitral award on the basis that there's a foreigner who is an arbitrator. You can set it aside only on three very narrow grounds that go to the root or the jurisdiction of the arbitral panel. So when it is possible, when it is all right to have commercial disputes settled by persons who are not citizens of this country, foreigners who form arbitral tribunals, why is it anathema to have judges from other jurisdictions to ensure independence? So this is a matter that I would urge the House to consider as a very important aspect. The other issues are with regard to the code of conduct. I want to highlight one or two matters, particularly with regard to the duty of disclosure by members of parliament. And when that is done, the country will know that when a member of parliament speaks or acts in this house, what conflict he or she suffers. And that disclosure is made well in time. So members' interests in contracts, in companies, in various other activity must be disclosed beforehand, so that whenever some issue arises in connection with something that the member is otherwise connected to, the disclosure is already made. As it is, the duty is cast on us to make that disclosure. It is not that we cannot participate, but we must make the disclosure. But if there is a conflict, then we must desist from functioning. It is not only that, it is also with regard to the order to be maintained in Parliament, that the new code of conduct, together with the standing orders, now provide for...
Well, member, you have 3 more minutes.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. For stricter punishment, it's unfortunate that those provisions had to be done in order to enforce discipline. But as we all know, even in this parliament, there have been incidents which we are all ashamed of, that ought not to have happened, but still happens. Even very recently it happened. And so it has become necessary, I think, to in order to enforce certain measure of discipline, without actually violating the freedom that members have to express themselves, not only in speeches but in various other ways. But yet, for the orderly conduct of business of the House, these measures are important. And I commend the standing orders report and the code of conduct for members of parliament. And I hope this House will adopt it today with the necessary adjustments, amendments that members propose and discuss being accepted. It's important that we send a message to the country today, sir, that amidst this speculation, amidst this uncertainty, that this House is still able to function and has in fact conducted a business which is very important for democracy, transparency, and a strong legislature. Thank you.